So, good afternoon, everybody. Welcome to this afternoon's class on approach to movement disorders. You're all with me? Are you able to listen? Okay. Next couple of classes, we'll be concentrating on movement disorders. So, this first class, we'll have an approach to this particular problem. Just before the others join, and I just wanted to show that I worked in FMC about 6 or 7 years. I worked in Delhi total about 11-12 years. Then I worked in KMC Manipal. I was trained in National Hospital for Neurology and Neurosurgery, Queen Square, for movement disorders under Dr. Quinn and Dr. Bhatia. It's in Bharati Hospital where now I'm working, Bharati Vidyapeeth. So the approach is slightly different here. What I will do is I'll initially summarize various types of movement disorders, and then we'll concentrate on approach to clinical assessment. As I said, approach to a patient with movement disorder is slightly different. What we teach in classical neurology diagnosis is where is the lesion and what caused the lesion. However, in this movement disorders approach, slightly there is slight difference. We start with what is the movement disorder phenomenology. Then comes where is the lesion and what is the lesion and etiology. The phenomenology is very important. That's what we will learn in the first few slides. They can be broadly divided into akinetic rigid syndromes or hypokinetic syndromes and hyperkinetic disorders. The akinetic rigid syndromes will have Parkinson's disease, and the Parkinsonism features are predominant trap, tremor, rigidity, akinesia, and postural disturbances, progressive supranuclear palsy, multiple system atrophy. The hypokinetic disorders are essential tremor, chorea, atherosis, balismus, tics, and dystonia. So let's concentrate initially on rigidity only. So because this is a very important aspect, if you observe in a neurology examination, usually by and large, many people skip examination of extrapyramidal system. So let's start. How do we assess? Rigidity is increase in resistance to slow passive movement, which can be accentuated by large range excursions in the opposite limb. That's called Frohman's sign. That means if you want to test on the right limb, if you make the patient do on left side a large amplitude movement, and this will reinforce the rigidity on the examination side. Lead pipe is a simple increase in resistance. If there is a superimposed tremor on the rigidity, it becomes physiology. If you ask what is due to spasticity, you will be able to tell that it is cortical release and there will be disinhibition, so there will be increase in the tone. But slightly you have to understand why rigidity comes. The rigidity is because of activation of the descending reticulospinal tract from the nucleus reticularis giganticocellularis and is in the RAS system, and that leads to a inhibition of 1B interneuron and simultaneously facilitates 1A interneuron. So the magnitude of rigidity correlates with a reduction in short latency autogenic 1B interneuron inhibition. That is basically 1B interneuron inhibition and simultaneous 1A interneuron facilitation. So this balance, when it is tilted, you will lead to rigidity. So MPTP, and that's the first drug to have caused the Parkinson's syndrome, causes excessive activation of this pathway. So as I said, increased stiffness is not a major source, but it's all the same, it's important. One of the most disabling features of Parkinsonism is akinesia. Bradykinesia. And see arrests in ongoing moment, it affects all moments of daily living. It results also in many additional features like lack of facial expression, lack of arm swing, and lack of when you walk, that freeness is not there in the arms. That is lack of arm swing. So we have this problem with akinesia. And how do we assess? We usually teach the students how to assess, but many of them are not aware how to assess. It is done by rapid, repetitive, alternate movement. One of the best things to master examination is to concentrate on UPDRS scale, which I'm going to tell in this, but we will concentrate on that next class. May I request rapid repetitive alternate movements, finger tapping. When you go on tapping the finger, you may have to continue to doing it for some time before you see that there is a loss in amplitude and the finger taps become fatigue. Opening and closing fist, coordination of the wrist. And in the lower limb, you may have to do a toe tapping or heel tapping. If you have to do heel tapping, you have to lift foot 3 inches and tap the floor with heel repeatedly. Toe tapping is more sensitive than heel tapping. And similarly, you can do a shoulder swing and an arm swing. So what you are looking in all this is whether there is a fatigue that is setting in or the amplitude of the movement is coming down and resulting in arrest. So that's how you test the akinesia or bradykinesia. So now postural disturbance. This is in advanced cases, there is no problem. Simian posture, flexed posture. But before that, you will have to test for postural instability and you have to do a retropulsion, propulsion and see the falls, whether he is falling en bloc by doing a pull test. When you are doing a pull test, please do not stand too close to the individual. Give some space for the individual to fall on. You have to support him. And you assess the gait for start hesitation, whether there is any shuffling. And while you make him walk, you see for the arm swing, and whether he is taking turns correctly or there is freezing, and or is there any falls. Is the gait improved by visual cues? Sometimes you draw a line, you put a scale, put a laser light. No, that will improve the gait. So that's also you have to examine. Let's see a video. The staff has a stiff, almost toe walking, and because of the severe stiffness. Right. Next, let's see. There's a stiffness. We'll have more of videos subsequently. Now the hyperkinetic movement disorders. We'll go on to tremor and we'll learn about dystonia, atherosclerosis, chorea, ballism, myoclonus and tics. To some extent we'll see, tics is a very interesting topic, and maybe we'll do some other non-specific ones also. Let's concentrate on the rhythm disturbance, that is the tremor, and it's a sinusoidal movement of a body part due to regular contraction of synchronous or alternate. So to assess the tremor, you have to observe whether it is at resting stage or it's in the positional static and action or it is in kinetic. Okay, So rest tremor is characteristic of Parkinson's disease that most of you know. But next we'll see why tremor is important. Because most common movement disorder is tremor. So you acquire as much knowledge as possible about the tremor which can be encountered in Parkinsonism syndromes. It is a part of essential tremor, exaggerated physiological tremor. So there are cerebellar tremor, dystonic head tremor. So there are various types of etiologies are there. It can be in the upper limbs, it can be in the neck, it can be in the legs. So you test in the upper limbs by resting the hands in the lap with hand supported, and or you may sometimes ask them to do a serial sevens or months backwards so that there's a distraction and the tremor will come up. The arms can be outstretched and re-emergent tremor can happen in Parkinson's disease and during movement, intention tremor, and during a task, if there is a writer's cramp and writer's tremor, dystonic posturing can happen with fingers, wrists and shoulder. So it can be in the legs also, resting with or without mental distraction, you have to test. So that's the position. And so the consensus statement on tremor is, the terminology is given like this. One is rest tremor. Two is action tremor. 2.1 is postural tremor. 2.1.1, position independent postural tremor. 2.1.2, position specific postural tremor. That finishes the postural tremor. And next is kinetic tremor. 2.2 is kinetic tremor. And 2.2.1, unspecific kinetic tremor. That is non-goal directed movements, repetitive flexion, extension movements, etc. Tremor during a goal directed movement is intention tremor. That is, and task specific kinetic tremor is 2.2.3 and 2.4. The tremor consensus statement is like this. Now I'll show you an interesting mute all. I will have to mute all. Otherwise, we'll keep on saying. Right. Next, you see, this is a very interesting table. And you remember this, the test to do tremor, whenever examination is there, you have to ask for frequency and how it is activation. The physiological tremor has a frequency of 10 hertz and it can be brought on by posture and a goal directed. Similarly, enhanced physiological tremor. Whereas essential tremor syndromes are classical essential tremor, undetermined tremor syndrome, orthostatic tremor, and task or position specific tremors, they have slightly medium to higher frequencies. The task or position specific tremor has more thing, and they are always activated by posture. The dystonic tremor has got 5 to mostly 5 hertz per second. And it is seen in goal directed, or you are looking sometimes and that is precipitated by goal. The Parkinson's disease tremor is 5 hertz and it is mostly seen in the rest. The cerebellar tremor is lower frequency, 0 to 5, and it is again posture and goal. The Holmes tremor is also slow. Palatal tremor, which I will show you, palatal myoclonus, it is 0 to 5 and it is seen at the rest. So the neuropathic tremor syndromes also have some medium size, 5 to 10, and posture. Drugs, medicines, and toxics can give from 2 to 10 hertz, and psychogenic tremor also has 5 to 10 frequency, and it is seen on posture. So this is in broad the differential diagnosis of tremor, and these various names you'll have to remember so that you can answer in exam. I'll show you an interesting video and see how. Oh, I'm sorry. Right. The lady has a severe tremor. And you see, this lady cannot even walk. She can't even drink. It's very, 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 very difficult. And here, see. So while examining tremor, you have to attain various postures. You have to outstretch the hands. You have to do and bring them back. And you see, like I'm doing now, it's outstretched. Put my hands like this, hand like this. Then you have to come to various conclusion. And this lady has this white matter hyperintensity, and she also has some abnormality in the spinal cord. Most of you would have guessed the diagnosis. And she also has lesions in the red nucleus area and gross tremor and thalamus. So the cerebellothalamocortical pathways are disturbed. Pontocerebellar and dentator rubra thalamocortical tract disturbance giving rise to a lot of tremor. And she was treated appropriately and with a lot of improvement. So when you see such patients, you get a lot of satisfaction that yes, we can treat the patients, and if provided, we are able to diagnose. So this is to just make you more interested. And so the activation of the tremor is right. These are the various tremor syndromes. So action or rest tremor, focal tremor, task specific orthostatic tremors, and tremors with additional signs and others. So these are available. Since this is an approach, we will not. So activation of the tremor, is it at rest, that is Parkinson's disease, on action? Is it postural, position independent, position dependent? And is it isometric tremor? And if it is kinetic, simple intention tremor or task specific kinetic tremor? So you will have to come to a conclusion about what this individual has. That is an approach to tremor. Now we'll go on to the dystonia. we so far completed rigidity, and we talked about tremor and postural instability and akinesia and bradykinesia. And now we'll go on to the other movement disorder, the dystonia. The movement disorder characterized by sustained or intermediate muscle contractions causing abnormal, often repetitive movements, posture, or both. So the concept which everybody has is that it could be a sustained contract posture. No, it's not sustained. It can be intermediate muscle contractions causing various abnormal postures or repetitive movements. They are typically twisting and maybe tremulous. It's often initiated or worsened by voluntary action and is associated with overflow into adjacent or distant muscles. So the axis 1 is the clinical characteristics which you have to describe, and axis 2 is the etiology. When in coming classes, we will concentrate on one class on Parkinson's disease, maybe next time, next week, next class. And after that, we'll concentrate on dystonia. And in that setting, we'll close movement disorders with these three classes. So the age of onset and body distribution and associated features are very important in understanding dystonia. That is axis 1. The age will tell you what type of dystonia you are seeing in a patient. So DYT1 dystonia is 11 years. Writer's cramp is around 38 to 40 years. Cervical dystonias is about 40 years. Segmental dystonias, laryngeal dystonias, 43 years or 50 years. I'll show you one of the cases. And blepharo and oromandibular dystonias around 55 years. So all dystonias, focal dystonias, have got a specific age of onset. So it's very interesting to know about dystonia, because there are various ways of understanding this. The primary dystonia, let us concentrate. Age of onset of symptoms and distribution of primary dystonia. The secondary dystonias can be because of many etiologies, which we'll see in next couple of slides. When it is a genetic one, and the anatomical distribution tells you, if it is less than 25 years, that means in children, it is generalized. And it has typically limb onset and it spares head and neck. These are the important points. So whenever you get an exam case, children, that could be primary dystonia if it is generalized. It has a typical limb onset and head and neck are spared. 25 to 45 years, usually that is the cervical dystonia, and task-specific upper limb dystonias like writer's cramps, it is usually focal dystonia. And more than 45 years is cervical dystonia or head and neck dystonias, and dystonia affecting legs almost never seen in more than 45 years. So these are very, very important points in understanding dystonia and to memorize how you differentiate a primary dystonia in adults from a primary dystonia in children or young adults. Let's see some cases here. Cervical dystonia. So over the course of years, there will be no type of dystonia, and these patients will be usually they are amenable for treatment with botulinum toxin. We'll show you some interesting videos which have responded to treat with botulinum toxin, and it can be yes tremor, it can be no tremor, and the most of the muscles which to be assessed correctly, the sternocleidomastoid, trapezius on same side, and this is psychological dystonia. And so that also sometimes you can encounter. So spinous capitis on one side, sternocleidomastoid and trapezius
dystonia.
Maybe hotspot will connect or what, it will be better.
That is my
अरे खाना नहीं खाया
that is EMG. So focal dystonias encompass so many other things also, blepharospasm, this is again cervical focal dystonias. So action, more mandibular dyskinias along with cervical dystonia. So, can be effectively intervened with botulinum toxin injection. Now you see the palatal myoclonus which has got 0 to 5 flow frequency of the palatal myoclonus which you are able to see in this video. This is the dysphonia which we are going to inject. Adductor dysphonia and abductor dysphonias, these are troublesome things where people will not be able to talk. So the arytenoid muscles will be injected through botulinum toxin, and this is the practice you can develop. So we inject it directly. You wait for the EMG signal to come. And there is a particular anatomical location and a direction of the needle which will enter the muscle. And people may do with the help of ENT specialists.
In which muscle?
This must be vocal cord, sir. Last time I went to the botulinum toxin.
Yeah, you got the signal and you inject. Now you see this is another type of dystonia.
In which I mean they inject into the
this case was given to me in Vizag to inject on a platform when we were conducting the workshop. See, he's got retrocollis severe, oromandibular dystonia, is severely disabled, and see the movements which are happening around the neck, various muscles are going into contraction. There is masseter muscle, pterygoids, lateral and medial pterygoids, the retrocollis compartment. So after appropriate intervention and treatment, after assessment on the stage, and to our surprise, this man has become so well, and it's a very good response which we could see in 7 days. So this is one of the friends from Tirupati's case, but we injected in Vizag on this thing. Right. So this is another case which you can see. See how severe hair dystonia is. DYT5, that is the dopa responsive dystonia. This girl had severe disability. So she has been injected in Manipal. She came all the way from Hyderabad for injection, and we have diagnosed her as dopa responsive dystonia, and now she is, after the injection, now she has disappeared. Complete improvement, satisfaction. So you have to learn dystonia, and you have to learn assessment of the muscle. The muscle anatomy is very important, and assessment is very important. So the body distribution wise, focal, segmental, multifocal, generalized dystonia without leg involvement, or hemidystonia, or it can be based on the patterns, static or progressive, and it can be persistent, action specific, diurnal, paroxysmal. The associated features: isolated dystonia, dystonia combined with other movement disorders and with other neurological or systemic manifestations. So there is a way to remember dystonia and its associations, which I'll be describing in the next couple of slides. The primary dystonia is present in isolation with no other neurological deficits. The plus syndromes are accompanied by one other neurological abnormality, typically Parkinsonism or myoclonus. The secondary dystonias are due to external factor, a toxin or a drug. Heterodegenerative dystonias occur as a feature of a generalized inherited neurological disorders. So you remember in this, the three important thing ones is the dystonia, Oppenheim's dystonia, DYT1, that is 9, chromosome number 9, DYT5, chromosome number 14, that is dopa responsive dystonia, DYT11, which is myoclonus dystonia. These are frequently occurring, and you should remember there are discoveries about the genes about dystonia, but for students to remember it's very difficult. So I feel that you should concentrate on remembering only these three. So the heterodegenerative dystonia can be remembered by two slides. You remember these two slides, and at least the broad headings: the metal or mineral metabolism, Wilson's disease, neurodegeneration with iron accumulation, earlier known as Hallward and Sparge disease, neuroferritinopathies, idiopathic basal ganglia calcification. The LSDs are lysosomal storage disorder, Niemann-Pick, GM1 and GM2 gangliosidosis, metachromatic leukodystrophy, Krabbe's disease, Pelgius-Wedge-Becker, NCL and fucosidosis. This is second group. The third is inborn errors of metabolism: Lesch-Nihan, glucose transport defects, aromatic amino acid decarboxylase deficiencies, amino and organic aciduria, that is glutaric acidemias, homocystinuria, propionic acidemia, and Hartnup disease. These are the four groups which are in this slide. And in the second one, you have mitochondrial disorders, Lees and Lebers, the trinucleotide or repeat disorders, Huntington's, SCA3, that is McCarthy-Joseph disease, and other spinocerebellar ataxias, gene mutations can have dystonia, PSP, MSA, and CBDD, juvenile onset PD, X-linked dystonia and Parkinsonism, and rapid onset dystonia and Parkinsonism. So sometimes you may take time to diagnose, but if you keep on observing the patients, you may diagnose them. Other degenerative processes we read in the cerebellar disorders: ataxia, telangiectasia, chorea, acanthocytosis, ataxia with vitamin E deficiency, etc. So with so many things in mind, how are we going to remember? So a method in examination, if you follow that method, then you will be able to at least come nearer to the diagnosis. So whenever dystonia is observed with Parkinsonism, you think of Parkinson's disease, PSP, MSA, CBGD, Wilson's, Huntington's, and the neuronal brain iron accumulation syndrome and rapid onset dystonia Parkinsonism. So this is one important group. The second one is when you examine eye and there is eye movement disorder, then you think lysosomal storage disorder, Niemann-Pick's, ataxia, telangiectasia, Wilson's, Huntington's, PSP, etc. And dystonia with prominent bulbar involvement, again neuro is very important in adults, as last class also we were discussing about it. Peripheral neuropathy, you look for peripheral neuropathy, and you, if you find it and it leads to metachromatic leukodystrophy and spinocerebellar ataxia, some types neuroacanthocytosis and GM2 gangliocytosis. So examination of a dystonia patient, you should concentrate and rule out features of Parkinsonism, eye movement abnormalities, bulbar involvement, ataxia and peripheral neuropathy. So remember these five groups, at least you will reach to somewhere in the differential diagnosis to discuss the various features in examination. That will bring to us chorea. The word that is associated with chorea is random. Here, random muscles are affected at random times with activity in random distribution. The movements flow, dance from one part of the body to the other. The chorea has got very many etiologies, a lot of etiologies are there. And the etiological classification is a genetic choreas and non-genetic choreas. Very important in exam. If you get a short case of chorea, then you will be asked many of these questions. Drug-induced choreas, vascular choreas, infectious choreas, immunological choreas, endocrine, metabolic choreas, and miscellaneous varieties. And the genetic choreas, as you know, is characteristically in children is benign hereditary chorea, in adults it is Huntington's disease, and various phenotypes of Huntington's disease also show chorea. The non-genetic choreas, you can see in one of the big studies, stroke accounted for about 21 of 42 cases. Drugs, neuroaids, hyperglycemia, hyponatremia, hypoxia, borreliosis, vasculitis, Sydenham's chorea. So you come across so many of these things. As I said, in children, it is benign hereditary chorea or Sydenham's chorea. What we grew up seeing a lot of Sydenham's chorea because of rheumatic fever. But there's one more entity that is more common, is a benign hereditary chorea, and basal ganglia stroke because of various reasons can also result, and post-operative ischemic brain changes and functional forms are also described in children. See, and what are the drugs that can induce chorea? Levodopa and dyskinesias are well known with levodopa. Dopamine agonists, anticholinergics, lamotrigine, phenytoin, methylphenidate, and ciproheptadine, and that is periactin, cocaine, lithium, carbon monoxide, mercury, digitalis, neuroleptics. So many of these drugs also. So drug history is another important one. As I said, vascular causes. If at all you see balism, that is stroke only. Hemichorea, hemibolism after stroke. Hemibalismus is always due to stroke. Post-pump chorea, Moyamoya disease, anoxic encephalopathy can give rise to chorea. And majority of the lesions can be outside subthalamic nucleus. And most of you know that diabetes, hyperglycemia is the most common risk factor as chorea, as well as hyperglycemia can directly induce chorea. And infectious causes like AIDS, Japanese encephalitis, measles, mumps, West Nile River encephalitis, and the neurocysticercosis lesions, the whooping cough, diphtheria, and malaria and syphilis. So these also can cause, and opportunistic agents, HIV encephalopathy, these are the most common in the early part of the 21st century. We saw a lot of HIV associated choreas and encephalopathy. They have come down now. The immunological causes to remember are Sydenham's chorea and chorea gravidarum, contraceptive induced chorea, SLE antiphospholipid antibody syndrome, acute disseminated encephalomyelitis, celiac disease. So if you are asked how are you going to investigate chorea, this is the approach which you have to remember all this. Let's learn briefly about Sydenham's chorea. Age of onset is 9.2 to 2 years. It's more common in girls, and carditis is seen up to 80%, and Jones criteria for acute-traumatic fever diagnosis, and chorea is one of them. And generalized chorea or hemichorea, like attention deficit hyperactivity and obsessive compulsive nature, dysequilibrium syndrome, and it can be associated migraine type headache, and there may be some tics. So Sydenham's chorea unsurprisingly responds to haloperidol. So natural history of Sydenham's chorea is it shows slowly, the temporal pattern shows that it improves over course of time. SLE, it is rare, 3.8%. Often it may precede the diagnosis of SLE. So now the chorea's investigation panel should include autoimmune antibodies, ANA and dsDNA. It has got an associated features like Parkinsonism, myoclonus, vascular thrombosis, psychosis. So American Rheumatic Association criteria for SLE, you should remember, and whenever you suspect them, you will have to mention few of them. The endocrine metabolic chorias, thyrotoxicosis, liver failure, adrenal insufficiency, metabolic factors, you have to check if you encounter chorea in acute setting. The benign hereditary chorea is autosomal dominant. It is a gene 14, chromosome 14, childhood onset, and there may be some lung fibrosis and lung diseases. Huntington disease is dementia, behavioral disorders, and movement disorders. It is a trinucleotide repeat disorder and CAG unstable expansion in chromosome 4. There is genetic anticipation, that means the children will have earlier onset of these. The numbers versus phenotype, less than 35 are normal, and 27 to 35 can produce abnormal, and 36 to 39 incomplete penetrance, more than 39 complete penetrance. Okay. Autosomal dominant phenocopies, I told you this Huntington's has got C9 and frame 72, Huntington's disease like, and spinocerebellar ataxia 2, spinocerebellar ataxia 17, and the benign hereditary chorea, neuroferritinopathy. So there are some phenotypes which will resemble Huntington's disease. So you'll have to remember them. That will bring to us to balism, which is a variant of chorea on the extreme end of the chorea spectrum. Particularly involves proximal joints and resulting in a large amplitude flinging movements. Most often in a hemi body distribution, hemi balismus or hemi chorea. It's only suggestive of a contralateral lesion, typically involving the striatum or the subthalamic nucleus. We'll briefly discuss about myoclonus, which is a brief shock-like muscle jerks, shock-like, brief, and arrhythmic or rhythmic, oscillatory. They can be focal, segmental or multifocal. They can be generalized and asynchronous or synchronous. They can be spontaneous or reflex onset myoclonus or action myoclonus. Physiological classification is, that means there is another way of looking at it, that is, one is a clinical way and the other one is a physiological way, cortical, subcortical, segmental, and proprio-spinal. The proprio-spinal is in the spinal cord, and the proprio-spinal things are connections between various spinal cord segments. There will be intermediate and long and short neurons which connects various spinal segments, and contraction of these will give rise to proprio-spinal myoclonus. Now the tics. These are intermittent, repetitive, stereotyped movements and motor tics or vocal tics. Sometimes tics are confused with seizures, and many people get treated brief repetitive jerk or simple unarticulated sound, it is simple. If there is a coordinated sequence of movements or linguistically meaningful utterances, then it becomes complex. And typically they are suggestible and they are distractible also. So these are the characteristics of the tics. And the next thing is the simple motor tics, and they have an urge to perform. These voluntary components like eye blinking, eyebrow raising, nose flaring, grimacing, mouth opening, tongue protrusion, platysma contraction, head jerking, shoulder shrugging and neck stretching, arm jerks, fist clenching, abdominal tensing, pelvic thrusting, buttock sphincter tightening, hip flexion or abduction, kicking, knee extension, foot dorsiflexion, toe curling, these are all simple motor tics. Phonic tics, sniffing, gnawing, clearing throat, shrieking, barking, coughing, humming, etc. The complex motor tics are head shaking, teeth gnashing, wrist shaking, finger cracking. Complex vocal tics are coprolalia, wide variety of abuses, unintelligible words, whistling, belching, stuttering, stammering, echolalia, palilalia. Now, so you will be seeing some cases where stuttering will be asked or stammering. There's a tic. You can't really do anything about it. They have to overcome it by themselves. So now we have seen what are the various movement disorders. Now we'll discuss how to approach the clinical assessment. This is very, very important. You have to examine top to bottom, and you have to be very diligent in the aspects which I'm going to show now. That's very, very important. It starts with cognition and behavior, especially the exam going batch of the DNB, the mental status, the MMSC. MoCA is more sensitive, but it's difficult, but you do MMSC, some frontal lobe dysfunction battery, couple of tests, you do aphasia testing, and do mood assessment with depression scale, but the Hamilton depression scale, you have it with you, emotional ability, obsessive compulsive disorders, and hallucinations and delusions, and any level of alertness and attention, you comment. So this is the observation as far as cognition and behavior is concerned. The other general assessment is autonomic function, whether there is any orthostatic hypotension, the timing and company it keeps, whether it's mostly after lunch or early morning waking up. So these things, and on examination, if there is any ergonomegaly, and examine the skin and nails for liver disease and Wilson's, and vascular disease for hypertension and tendinous xanthomas, facial appearances. You look for wide-eyed, staring, anxious expression, excessive tearing, conjunctival injection, cranial dystonia, facial action myoclonus, mouth opening, drooling early in course, other facial movements and dysmorphic features. So just imagine how much diligently you have to do an examination. Eyelids, whether unilateral or bilateral eyelids, asymmetric and symmetric, whether there is reduced blinking, blepharospasm, nerve, retinitis pigmentosa. So these are things which should be in the mind of all the neurology residents. And this is the KF ring which you are seeing here. Here also, you can see. The eye movements, one of the important for a neurologist is to master the examination eye movements. A failure to make immediate eye contact, square wave jerks, slow vertical saccades, downward saccades, optokinetic nystagmus, and testing of vestibular ocular reflex, supranuclear vertical gaze palsy, slow saccadic and spasms of fixation, nystagmus. So various types of eye movements which you can test, you have to be very careful in doing that. Other facial features like glabellar tap response, the stimulus sensitive facial and axial myoclonus, the facial tremor, perioral, perinasal, jaw, other facial muscles, the tongue at rest, atrophy, tongue protrusions, orolingual apraxias, oromandibular tongue dyskinesias, palatal myoclonus, which you have seen, maybe clicks or heard, the brisk jagger. So see, a voice and speech, high-pitched, quivering or strained voice, low-pitched, nasal, harsh voice, extreme hypophonia, palilalia, echolalia, scanning, slowed speech, speech apraxia, spasmodic dysphonia, which I showed you we were injecting, respiratory pattern disturbances. There may be stridor, inspiratory pattern disturbances, which is common in MSA, inspiratory gasp, stridors, low-pitched moaning. Colles or retrocoa drop head syndrome and other cervical dystonias, which you have seen the video, which very, very characteristically seen. Again, the distribution of rigidity and axial rigidity is more or appendicular rigidity is more. The, usually the axial rigidity is characteristic of Parkinson's plus syndromes. So by, you can guess by looking at his gait, turns whether he is taking inward complete rest. Arms should be outstretched, rotated to palms up, arms in front of the face, wing posture for the proximal tremor of red nucleus, rubral tremor, rapid response and alternating movements, finger taps, fist pronation, supination. Observe performance influence on other involuntary movements, like you said, prominent sign, in coordination, finger, nose, heel, shin, rapid tapping and a circle on the back of the hand, writing, drawing, drinking. And so there is no limit to the observations. You have to develop your observation skills a lot. The tremor at rest, postural, kinetic, we already discussed. And mini polymyoclonus postural tremor can be seen in outstretched fingers. The myoclonus spontaneous or stimulus sensitive, and dystonia at rest on action or flow, or the hyperkinetic movement disorders, ataxia, and features of corticospinal tract dysfunction, writing and drawing are performed early and fast, micrographia in Parkinson's disease. And in general, symmetry of involvement and limb size symmetry, whether the extremities are cold and discolored, amyotrophy, fasciculations, and apraxia testing, and cortical sensory loss, so which is usually forgotten, and evidence of peripheral nerve dysfunction, which I showed you, it's important in certain diseases with dystonia. So the stance and postural assessment, where the stance is upright posture, cantocormia or PISA syndrome, which we discussed in MSA, you have to make him rise and fall into the chair. Rapid raising with falling back into the chair, rocket sign, is again suggestive of a postural. And some people sit en bloc, right? So standing, that's en bloc is again a problem. This is a wheelchair sign. Standing in one spot, orthostatic tremor can be demonstrated, or myoclonus can be demonstrated. The pull test methodology is critical. Early en bloc falls, an unusual and bizarre response will be there. And so pull test, you have to give some place for the individual to come, okay. Now examine the gait in detail. The gait assessment is very, very important. So all of you should develop where your knowledge about gait assessment. Is it wide-based ataxic gait? And you have to calculate the cadence, the step length, the stride length, right? And the tandem walk examination, whether there is start hesitation, freezing, is there any spontaneous walking, whether carries a walking aid. Right, told last time we have discussed SARA scale for ataxia. Their gait assessment is given. And if the individual has problem only in gait, that is the lower half Parkinsonism, that is March Appetit Pass, is usually magnetic gait, and that is characteristic of vascular Parkinsonism. And there may be excessive arm swing for a stride, and apraxia including hopping, the foot leg dystonia, cock walk, atypical features like aesthesia, abasia, buckling and walking on ice, etc. So various types of gait abnormalities. And the caution about all this is you should be able to differentiate weakness versus difficulty in initiating movement and generating forceful contraction. Asymmetric reflexes are enhanced by rigidity. So don't get confused there. So rigidity will exaggerate the reflexes. There is difficulty in differentiating between the slowness of bradykinesia and limb kinetic apraxia and pyramidal tract dysfunction. This you will develop over course of your thing. And there should not be over-interpretation of apraxia or cortical sensory changes in severely dystonic rigid limb, because the answers may be wrong. So you should be able to differentiate Parkinsonism plus with Parkinson's disease plus, right? Parkinson's disease plus dementia type. So approach to movement disorders. So first I stress phenomenology, whether it is akinetic rigid, a Parkinsonian syndrome, or hyperkinetic disorder, or a combination. Then you determine the hyperkinetic disorders based on the phenomenology, whether it is tremor, dystonia, achitosis, chorea, ballism, myoclonus, or tics. So diagnosis of hyperkinetic movement disorders is by the appearance. Type of movement disorder is not a disease specific one. The same disease may present with varying types of hyperkinetic movement disorders with an individual or between individuals also. So what is the phenomenology, what is the lesion if possible, and what is the etiology? So let us review. Is there excessive movement? Yes. If there is an excessive movement, is it rhythmical or non-rhythmical? We'll see. If there is no excessive movement, bradykinesia, cognitive, language, UMN, sensory science, so degenerative Parkinsonism, this is the line. If there is rigidity or tremor, that is of course TRAP, Parkinson's disease. So whenever Parkinson's disease is there, you will have to be careful to rule out Parkinsonism plus and all these other test, features which I described, you will have to examine. Suppose if there is excess movement, is it with rest Parkinson's disease? Is it with posture, essential physiological tremor, distal tremor, thyrotoxic? It is intention, cerebral or brainstem tremor. And if it is not rhythmical and achitosis, dystonia, it can be chorea, ballism and myoclonus. So these are the various movement disorders which we discussed today. And I think I have introduced you to the phenomenology of the movement disorders. We discussed briefly about rigidity, about the tremor, about the dystonia. But we'll discuss along with cases in the coming classes about more of movement disorders. And now if you, any of you have any questions we can take, and any suggestions. And I think you people should fill up the Google forms which are sent by Dr. Purnima, so that we have. And started electrophysiology classes by Dr. Sudhir Jagtap, and there was a suggestion of movement disorders we started. So like that, we'll cover up most of the topics which you people propose.
Hello. Hello, sir.
And she responded to Natalism. Okay, if there are no other doubts, and we'll say bye-bye from our end. But I wanted some volunteers for Monday's Journal Club on that, but nobody has come forward. Please send your names so that we can have some interactive discussion on that day. We'll be discussing a randomized controlled trial And that's on a COVID chloroquine trial, which is hotly debated nowadays. So if anybody wants, what is this case of dystonia, palatal tremor, and sensory ataxia?
I think they are talking this multiple sclerosis case.
Oh, okay. Titubation and head tremor. She has been investigated thoroughly for all the possible causes, including immune causes of connective tissue disorders, and she has responded to natalizumab very much. And so, okay, I think that link is available. We'll send you that link is available. You can register. Thank you very much. So then I'll take leave now, and we'll go on to next Monday. We'll meet. Thank you. Let's finish.